Okay, so there's a lot to do here. What we're going to be doing is we're going to be factoring quadratic equations, and then we're going to just solve them by the zero product property. So don't forget, I did post a video on zero product property, so you might want to go look at that if you have any questions on that. So let's, lots to do here, so let's get after it. Okay, so this is factoring a quadratic. In this case, I'm going to be factoring out a monomial, and I want to remind you that if we're dealing with a quadratic equation, oftentimes we're looking at this form where there's three terms. Well, when there's only two terms, oftentimes we can just say, is there something that they both have in common, that we can factor out of both? And there is, right? We can take out an x. So that's the monomial we can remove. Let's take out the x. And just remember, what's inside the parentheses is the result of this division problem. So if we're taking out an x, we have to divide by an x to see what's left inside. So if I take out the x, I'm dividing it, leaves me with x minus, and if I divide out an x there, I get x minus 11. Now here comes the zero product property, where we do now have a product of something set equal to zero, so let's separate those. X is zero. X minus 11 is 0, and if you solve these individually, well, we already have an answer of 0, and we have an answer of 11. So I'll take 0 and 11. Another way of writing the answer would be using these brackets, and these brackets oftentimes are just indicative that, hey, this is the answer to the problem. It is not a coordinate if you use the brackets. Put them in parentheses, you'd be almost indicating that we're dealing with a coordinate. The answers are 0 and 11 because we were able to factor out an x. Two terms, that's what we want to look for first, okay? So let's look for another one here. Go ahead and see if you can solve that problem. Two terms. Let's factor out a monomial. Okay, so hopefully your eyes went to the fact that they both have in common a factor of 9x. So let's take out a 9x. And if I divide that by 9x, I get x, and I divide that by 9x, I get 2. Separate them. And solve them individually for x. I'm going to get, oops, it's not an x. X is 0, and x is negative 2. And again, just as a reminder, it's okay to write the answer like that. Okay? Job. Okay, last one where we can take out a monomial. Let's see if we can do this one on our own. Okay, I'm actually going to do this two different ways. So let's split the board in half here. But the first one's the easiest, and you can just say, well, they both have an x I can take out. So let's take out the x. If I remove the x, I'm dividing by it, and that leaves me with 7x minus 11, and then we can separate them. But I still have to solve for x. This one's already handled. Add over the 11, divide by 7, and we're going to get two answers. And that's sufficient. It's one way of doing the problem. The other way of doing the problem, and I'll just write it over here. A lot of people wouldn't think about this, but if you don't like this leading coefficient of 7, we could think about actually factoring out a 7x. So let's see what that would look like if we did that. If we take out a 7x, remember what factoring does, it makes us divide by 7x. So 7x squared divided by 7x leaves me with an x. Minus. These x's cancel, leaves me with 11 sevenths. I still have the zero product property. I can separate these. And I can solve them individually, and I'll get the same thing. I'll get 0 and add over 11 sevenths, and I'll get 11 sevenths, and these two answers are reiterated over there. So two ways of thinking about it. The right answer is the right answer, but I wanted to show that to you. Okay? So if we're dealing with two terms, this is oftentimes our thought process. Is there something I can remove first? Okay? So let's look when there's three terms. Now I've said factoring quadratic equations with the leading coefficient of 1. Well, that's right here. There's a 1 that lives right there. And what I'm going to do here, and this may seem a little monotonous or even not even a requirement in your world, but it will make maybe more sense toward the end of why I do it this way, just out of habit. Since this is a 1 and this is a negative 18, I'm going to create what I call a factor sum table. Well, the factor is going to be 1 times negative 18. So I take the first and the last number and I just multiply them and I get negative 18. And the sum is always this middle term, which is negative 7. So think about what this means. What's factor mean? Factor means multiply. Sum means add. So all I'm really thinking about here is what times what is negative 18 when added together is a negative 7. And you could go through all your multiplication facts. I just want to point out, since this factor is negative, I know one of these has to be positive and one of them has to be negative. But when I add them, it stayed negative, so that would indicate that the largest has to be negative. So I'll just show you a wrong answer here. So if you think, well, how do I get 18? Well, I can get negative 18 times a positive. Well, that works, right? That is negative 18. And the sum for this would have been negative 18 plus 1. Well, that's obviously not negative 7. So those aren't the numbers I want. Well, it should be negative 9 and a positive 2, because that is negative 18, and a negative 9 plus 2 is 7, and that's the one I wanted. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to look right here, and I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to generate a binomial times a binomial. And I just want to remind you that the only way we're going to get x squared here, if you remember back to the FOIL method, would be first times first. So this has to be x times x. And the rest of the work is right there. I have a minus 9 I'm going to put here. And I have a positive 2 I'm going to put here. If you work this backwards, it would check out. Now we've got the zero product property. We can set these each equal to 0. And solve, so I can add 9, I'm gonna get 9. I can subtract 2 and get negative 2. And the answers could be negative 2 and 9. Okay? A lot of people will just focus on this one. What times what is this? When added together is this? And not necessarily pay attention to the 1, but when this becomes something other than 1, it becomes problematic to them. So I'm just starting you off correctly that way. Okay, so two more examples with a leading coefficient of 1. Let's see what you can do with this one. Okay, so in this particular instance, I have 1 times 44, so I'm going to be thinking about factoring a positive 44. My sum is negative 15. Again, I'm gonna factor, it means multiply. It's positive. There's only two ways to get a positive number when you multiply. They're either both positive or they're both negative. And when I'm adding these together, they gotta stay negative, which means these are both negative numbers based on the sum. So what times what is 44? Well, I've got 4 and 11. I make this negative 4 and negative 11, and I multiply these two numbers together, I will get a positive 44. And I add them, I'm going to get negative 15. So these work. This is what I want. Checks out on the factor side, checks out on the sum side. So again, I'm just going to grab these and bring these over in a binomial. Only way to get the x squared was an x times x. And then I'm just going to bring over my minus 4 and my minus 11. Set these equal to 0. and solve, I'm going to get 4 and 11. Okay, those would be the answers to that. Or again, totally okay to write x equals 4, x equals 11. Okay, last example with a leading coefficient of 1. Go ahead and pause the video and see what you can do. All right, so again, I'm going to take 1 times 50. I'm going to be factoring 50. And my sum is going to be a positive 27. And again, they're both positive here, and they're both positive here. That means they're both positive. So how do you get 50? Well, 2 times 25 and 2 plus 25. Works very nicely. Those numbers check out. That produces 50, that produces 27. So I'm just going to go over here, create my binomial, times binomial, x squared is x and an x, and just bring over the positive 2 and the positive 25. Separate. And solve each individually. Again, I'll kind of lazy here, not showing my work. I'll get x is negative 2. And x is negative 25. And we can write the answers from least to greatest accordingly. Or accordingly. It's up to you. Okay? Again, where would this cross the x-axis? It's going to cross at a negative 25 and it's going to cross at a negative 2. Okay? So there it is. Factor sum table, taking the first times the last. Factor that number. The sum is the middle term. Now, that hopefully will make a little bit more sense of why I was doing it that way when this thing is other than 1. Let's look at that. Okay? Now this is the grouping method. It's a little bit more arduous, and I know that some people will use what is called the guess and check, where they'll just start using binomials and they'll just play with numbers until they figure out which one works. I'm not big on guessing. I like a process that's going to work very cleanly. So I'm going to do the same thing I just did. I'm going to take this 4 times that 5, and I'm going to factor 20. And the sum is still 12. I'm going to ask myself, what times what is 20 when added together is 12? And we can be thinking about 2 and 10. 2 times 10 is 20. And 2 plus 10 is 12. Now here's the difference. When the leading coefficient was 1, I was just saying, let's use these. But now we're using the grouping method. I'm actually going to take this, and I'm going to bring them and replace the 12 with that addition problem, and this is why. The grouping method wants us to group things. And there's only 3 terms right now, and I want 4. Yeah, 4. I want 4 terms. So I'm going to take the 12, which is 1 term, and I'm going to replace it with 2 numbers, which will allow me to put 4 terms on the board. So this is what it looks like. Now, pay attention to this because this is really important. I'm going to just take this 4x squared and I'm going to drop it. And I am always, regardless of what this is, I'm going to write a positive right there. I'm going to write plus. Even if that was minus, I'm going to write a plus. So it will make sense toward the end. Open parentheses, bring that x in the back. Plus 5, and the only thing I'm going to do here is instead of a 12, I'm just going to write 2 plus 10 right here. And get that out of the way, maybe bring it a little closer up there. Okay, so now I've got here is I want to distribute this x. You can see what's about to happen. I distribute this x, I get 4x squared plus, this is now 2x. Plus 10x plus 5. This is why it's called the grouping method. This is the first time in this problem I can actually group something. and I can group the first two terms, and I can group the last two terms. Now there's two steps left in this problem. I'm going to factor each one of these if I can, and then I'm going to factor the whole thing. So watch this. I'm going to factor this by saying, what can I take out of this? Well, I can take out a 2x. So let's take out a 2x here. 2x, and what's left? Well, I divide that by 2x, I get 2x. Plus, I divide that by 2x, I get 1. Plus, what can I take out of this? Well, I can take out a 5. Divide by 5, I get 2x. Divide by 5, I get 1. Now check this out. These now match. And when I said I was going to group here and then group here, what I'm doing now is I'm asking myself, what can I take out of the whole thing? Well, they both match. I can take that out. And what's going to be left when I take this out is right there. So I have a 2x plus 1 times 2x plus 5. These are the factors of that quadratic. If I set them equal to 0, I'll kind of do it over here. Solve that one. I get x is subtract and divide. I'm going to get negative 1/2. And the other one was 2x plus 5. Set that equal to 0 and solve. I'll subtract the 5 and divide by 2. I'll get negative 5/2. So we can say, what is that? I said least to greatest, so that would have been first, and that would be second. And there they are. So there's the grouping method. First times last, just like before. I was just before taking the one times that number because I wanted to be in the habit of taking this times this and factoring and still having a sum of the middle, okay? I got a couple more examples here that we can work out. Just look back and make sure that we're all square here. I took out the 2x. Good, good. I took out the 5. That's perfect. I took that out. And that works out cleanly. Okay. So that looks right to me. So let's try one more. Okay. Again, what we want to do is we want to embrace the process. I mean, I don't have a clue when I'm solving this problem where this thing is crossing the x-axis. So the first thing I'm going to do is ask myself, what's 12 times 1? And I'm going to factor that number. Well, that's 12. 12 times 1 is 12. And what's my sum? Well, my sum is a positive 7. So what times what is 12? When added together is 7. Well, that's a 3 and a 4. Right? 3 times 4 is 12. And 3 plus 4 is 7. And remember, the grouping method is going to take these numbers right here and put them right there. Because the purpose is that we want that 3 terms, 1, 2, 3, to become 4. So let's go down and say, remember, even if this was minus, I'd write a plus here. Open parentheses. There's my x plus 1. Just to show you, the only thing that's changing is this 7 is going to become 3 plus 4 right there. And now we can distribute this x. And we're in a position where we can now group. And this is why it's called the grouping method. Let's group and group. Okay? So this is the first time we get to factor. I'm going to ask ourselves, within each parenthesis, what can I take out of that? Well, I can take out a 3x. Divide by 3x, I'm going to get 4x plus. Divide by 3x, I get 1. Let's go over here. There's nothing to factor out of that, so what we want to do is we want to take out a 1. I'm going to put a 1 right in front of the parenthesis. Also a very common mistake. Someone doesn't write the 1. But look, they match. And they will always match if this is factorable. If it's not factorable, this won't work anyway. If it works over here, it will work over here. Okay? So I can take out this 4x plus 1, and what's left? Well, 3x plus 1 is left. So there it is. There's the factors. 4x plus 1 times 3x plus 1. We can now separate those and solve for x. Let's do it here. 4x plus 1 equals 0. What was the other one? 3x plus 1 equals 0. I can subtract 1 and divide by 4, and I'm going to get x is negative 1/4. I can subtract 1 and divide by 3, and I'm going to get negative 1/3. And try to write these from least to greatest. Those are the answers. Again, it's a very clean method. This one might not have been terrible for you to play around with and guessing factors that may or may not work. I've had students in the past who were just brilliant at guessing. I'm just not big on guessing, so I'm giving you that process. Okay, let's look at another one. Now, I put this here on purpose because remember what I said, we're always gonna want this to drop down as a positive and it will make sense on this problem. So again, I've got a quadratic that has a leading coefficient that's not 1, so I'm always going to do the same thing. What's 2 times negative 12? So I'm going to factor negative 24, and my sum is still going to be this middle term, which is negative 5. And we're going to run through that, right? Like what times, and again, I know that it's negative. One has to be positive, one has to be negative, the factors. And then when I add them, I'm going to get a negative number. So I'm still thinking largest number is negative. And we should get, say, 8 and 3, negative 8 and 3. If I multiply those, I get that. I add them, I get that. So there they are. There's the values I want, right there. Grouping method requires going from 3 terms to 4, so let's see what that looks like. Now I'm still going to drop the 2x squared, and I'm going to remind you that bad boy had better be plus. And that's going to confuse some folks because they're going to be thinking, why? Why does that have to be a positive? But it's going to show up right here when I throw these numbers in. If I would have dropped the minus and threw them in, notice this is still negative. And a negative times a negative would have produced a positive, and it's not positive, it's minus. So if this is ever a minus, we'll drop a plus, but we'll just put our minus in here and it will work itself out. That's the requirement, okay? So let's distribute this x. And I just wanna point out that if I distribute this 8, I'm gonna get a negative 8x, right? But I'm not going to write plus negative. Now I can write the minus 8x. Plus, distribute. And now we can group. Let's group these, group these. And what can we take out? Well, we can take out a 2x. I'm going to be left with x minus 4. What can I take out here? I can take out a 3. I'm going to be left with x minus 4. And you start becoming very, very comfortable when you get to that point, feeling like you know you're right. Like they match. I'm feeling golden about this. I can take out that x minus 4. And what's left is right. There, 2x plus 3. Separate these. I now have x minus 4 equaling 0, and 2x plus 3 equals 0. I solve that, I get 4, and I solve that, I get negative 3/2. And if I want to write it this way, from least to greatest, like that. Okay? Now, one more example, and then we're going to call it a day. And this one's just a little bit harder to envision, so feel free to pause the video. Okay, larger numbers. I now have 20 times 6. So I am factoring 120. I'm not gonna lie. I teach math and I had to think about this problem. So I'll just kind of walk you through to remind you, hey, this is a positive, right? Something times something's producing this, that's positive. But when I add them, it's negative. So I already know they're both negative. I have to know that. Like that's a forethought. And if you didn't know what they were, you know, they're both negative, so it really didn't matter what order. You know, you would have started to walk down this thing like I did, thinking, boy, oh boy, I'm getting nowhere. And you would have eventually made it to negative 8 times negative 15. Negative 8 times negative 15 is a positive 120. And negative 8 plus negative 15 is a negative 23. So these are the numbers I want to put right there. And we'll be off and running. Again, it's minus here, but it better be plus here. I'm kind of running out of room, so I'm going to fix that. So let's put our negative 8 plus negative 15. There's my x on the end. There's my plus 6 equals 0. Notice I did write negative 8 plus a negative, because I mean, I'm already thinking, no matter what, I'm going to end up grouping two terms in the front, grouping two terms in the back, so I just wanted to be thinking about that I'm going to be separating these. So I get 20x squared, let's distribute this, and I get negative 8x plus negative 15x plus 6. And I can now group. Okay, so what can we take out of this? Well, I can take out a 4x. Divide that by 4x, I get 5x minus 2. I have a plus. Now I'm going to stop to point out, remember these have always matched. Notice how this is minus and it's not minus here. Sometimes I see that and I think, well, this is a minus, it better be minus over here. I'm going to be taking out a negative. And what else can we take out? Well, we can take out a negative 3. Divide that by a negative 3, I'm going to get 5x minus 2, and there they are. So I have 5x minus 2 times 4x minus 3. I'm kind of running out of room here, so you can see that if I separate these and solve for x, I'm going to get x is equal to 2/5, and I'm going to get x is equal to 3/4. Add the 2, divide by 5, add the 3, divide by 4. Okay? So the answers were 2/5 and 3/4. Okay, that's it. That's the last example. See you next time.